A study by the Social Welfare Department and UNICEF shows families raising children with disabilities have to spend 40 to 80% more than ordinary households. Health expenditure accounts for the largest source of extra costs, followed by transportation and education. Because of such expenses, the study says, children with disabilities are likely to experience poverty rates 50% higher than other children. How is the Philippine government supporting this sector? Let's talk to Mateo Lee Jr., the Deputy Executive Director of the National Council on Disability Affairs. Good morning, Sir Mateo. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, good morning, Nikki.
Okay, first off, sir, can you give us a background? Do you have background on the report? Do you have a figure on how many families have PWD members?
We're saying that we are about a million children that have been affected by the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And because of the figure, we are saying that the children with disability are more affected because they have been a problem of brought about by the different types and degree of the disability. So if you compare the children without disability with those with disability, it's even higher to maintain or to support. Parents have been having difficulty to support their children with disability, especially in times of COVID-19.
Mm-hmm. And sir, how many families have PWD members based on your data?
We're saying that right now we have 1,443,000 as of the census of the Philippine Statistics mm-hmm. Authority. 50% of these persons with disability are children with disability, and most of them are in the rural areas. And mm-hmm. so we have to support the children, especially in the geographically isolated disadvantaged area. And with this kind, we are trying to come up with a social pension support for all persons with disability. There are already bills filed in Congress, both in the lower house and in the upper house. And we are prioritizing children with disability to have an allowance of 2,000 pesos.
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Mateo, let's go back to the extra costs we talked about a little earlier. What are the main sources or reasons behind these extra costs concerning PWD families?
Mostly health medical needs of the children. As you all know, if you try to have a consultation for example, a child with autism, it's not a regular fee of 500 to 1,000 pesos. It's more than that that they spend to have a developmental pediatrician. And it's in some areas, we don't have much available developmental pediatrician. That's why it's all in the urban areas. And because of the limited medical expertise, the cost is too high. Mm-hmm. Regularly afforded by poor families.
And Sir Mateo, what are the basic services and forms of government that of aid that are currently in place for our PWD children, and why are they not enough?
Well, right now we have the issuance of ID with a 20% discount, mm-hmm. but according to the study, most children, even if they have the ID 20% discount, they cannot really avail of the services and the privileges brought about by this issuance of the ID, because most of our poor families have no ID. They cannot go to access ID system, apply for an ID. And mostly who are being benefited are at least those middle-income families that are able to have access to the urban centers, to the different local government units to apply for ID program. But our children in the rural areas, most of them, majority of them, if not 80% of the children, have no IDs. And so we really have to push more programs for the health issue, because this is one big problem for children to have access to health services, especially the presence of expert medical specialists in the rural areas. And of course, the other reason is the social services are basically only on basic needs like food, shelter, clothing, but most of them are just being given food, no, during crisis intervention. But sometimes the food is not appropriate to the different types of disabilities. There are food that will agitate child autism, for example, it will create tantrums, no. So there are studies that we have to provide also the appropriate nutritional food to this kind of children, the specific type of disabilities, because these are the things that have not been discussed most of our government.
So research must be more involved this time around. Sir Mateo, among the SWD and UNICEF recommendations given are the provision of disability allowances, as mentioned before, and the setup of a more comprehensive health database to improve the referral of children with disabilities to hospitals. Is this something you'd agree with and can actually be done?
Yes, we will do the necessary updating of some of the data in the referral program of the DSWD. We've been supporting the DSWD in this study with UNICEF, the National Council on Disability Affairs, is also engaged in the study. And so we know the issue, and we will be helping the department to advocate for more program development at the local government units.
And sir, you did mention earlier transportation costs. We know that travel to the metropolitan areas is also essential to access some services or medications that are... Are you working on making improvements here specifically on this issue?
Yes. In fact, we've been meeting with the infrastructure, the rail system. The Department of Transportation is on the pipeline for the construction of the rails from north to south, and the build project of the president. We would like all the train system to be compliant to Batas Pambansa 344, so that our persons with disability can readily access transportation. It's a big problem, Nikki. All throughout, we have been doing a lot of advocacy, but sometimes we are not involved in the planning and the construction. So some of the infrastructures were built already, and when we monitor, it's difficult to reconstruct because money has already spent. So we are now looking at the start of construction, and we are requesting these government agencies to involve us so that we can already see the design and monitor the whether the plan has been with Batas Pambansa 344 facilities. So these are the advocacy that we're doing right now to make sure the transportation in the Marcos administration will be compliant to the accessibility law for our children with disability.
And Sir, UNICEF Philippines representative Oyunsay Candendet-Norob has since said that the situation of children with disabilities has long challenged the way we approach inclusiveness and development and nation building. Do you agree, and how so?
Yes, because it's a really a long issue with the convention. You know, in 1989, we have the Convention on the Rights of the Child. In 2008, we have the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability. In both treaties, we have the children with disability rights being amplified and being reminded that state parties should be able to address their needs. But you see, until now, we still have to have a lot of children. Even accessing education is a big problem because we don't have teachers available in the last mile school that the DepEd is doing. In the rural areas, as children has to go to urban centers, and as a result, they have to be institutionalized and have to be separated from the families. This is not a good a strategy as far as our international organizations are concerned, because they don't want children with disability to stay in institution. Mm-hmm. They want the children to be in the community, living with their families. So until we will be able to have all these facilities, that education, for example, children with disability can access a school at their barangay with the teachers, inclusive classes are being implemented. And that's the only time we can say that we can make our children with disabilities stay in their families and be part of the community. Mm-hmm.
And sir, this study also comes at a time when we are recovering from a pandemic that has exacerbated pre-existing difficulties for everyone. How did the pandemic impact people and children with disabilities?
Well, very, very, very much, because, you know, children with disabilities cannot go to school during the pandemic. They don't have contact with teachers. Most of them don't have gadgets to be in the online, on blended learning, to have access to the internet. It's difficult for children with disability to just be in on the internet, because sometimes, mm-hmm. for example, you have to teach blind people hands-on to be able to know what is shapes, no? Because you cannot just describe it by pictures. You have to give them examples which the blind people can touch. Along also with those with autism, who have the different levels of appreciations of things. They don't have enough attention to stay in the internet. So you have to deal with different activities according to the different needs of the child with disability. So it's not easy to say, okay, you just put on your Zoom online and we'll help you give your textbooks or your lesson for the day. It's not just that we have to do it, because we have to do some innovation, and it can only be done if you have a face-to-face interaction with the teacher. Mm-hmm.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Sir Mateo. Thank you for your insights and your time. We'll continue hoping for the best and working towards the best. You stay
safe. Thank you very much, Nikki. Thank you to all of you.